Today I would like to momentarily reflect upon what has happened since February this year with regards to Russia and the invasion of Ukraine. Russia has taken a position that it doesn't want certain things of Ukraine. And it started out as a full-scale invasion of Ukraine. That invasion has failed effectively and has ended in a sort of a stalemate, bloody war of attrition where both parties cannot secure anything resembling a victory without more or less killing the other side in the most brutal manner possible. From a European perspective, we have a lot of sympathy for what happens in Ukraine because we understand the concept of a bully, of a more powerful nation accepting or invading and declaring full-on war against a smaller nation. This is a war of aggression by the from the perspective of the EU and people in Western Europe. We can easily envision the same thing happening. We like people. In Western Europe have a very strong cultural affinity with this. Strangely enough, you would expect Russians to have the same affinity because they were target of the German aggression some better part of a century ago, and that apparently didn't leave enough of an impression, or they are leveraging that fear of an outside enemy invading their country to make comparisons between Nazis and NATO. It is remarkable how effective propaganda is. Russia is clearly being able to propagandize its own population, although it must be said that the population doesn't have much choice. Even if they didn't believe it, they still have to act as if they do believe it, what the government is postulating. And there is no, if they have their doubts, there is like, it's from a Russian perspective, from a citizen's perspective, always sensible to choose the side of the government because, well, that's your team. There isn't much to be gained for a typical Russian to be too vocal about it in terms of personal risk, but also in terms of profit. They could stand aside and say, well, I'm not personally taking part of this invasion, but I support it because it's my countrymen. Our sons are battling here, and I can easily wash my hands by blaming an outside force like NATO. The question is always arises if Russia is anywhere comparable to the United States, and a similar thing would happen. Say, what we have in the Cuba Missile Crisis, and a hostile foreign alliance places large army units or a hostile, quote unquote, hostile ideology, political system on a neighboring country next to the United States. Well, it's fair to say that the United States will probably act as well in a similar situation. However, there's a difference. Russia right now is a really big country, but by no means it is the United States. It's an extremely fragile country, as it appears, with a very fragile and ill-equipped and very demoralized military. The question is, can Russia still make claims to extend its boundaries in a sort of a defensive manner, which clearly it has done in the Caucasus? It has been extending its boundaries in a way as to take natural barriers like mountains, etc., rivers, lakes, inland seas, and sort of created a defensive bulwark. The problem here is that Russia has created that defensive bulwark in other people's countries who do not necessarily consent to that. And that places immediately Russia in the position of an empire, where it says our collective imperial interests are bigger and more important, our safety concerns are more important than the concerns of small, low economy, low racial inferiority neighbors in the Caucasus or Ukraine. It's easy to mobilize arguments either way, and that's tricky. For Russia, it is therefore, you must conclude, not particularly difficult to win the internal war propaganda. Russia also has nukes, nuclear weapons, and they have more than 5,000, I think, more than 5,000 nuclear weapons, of which a large percentage is no longer, or not anymore, or it's still not, thermonuclear megaton range weapons. Those weapons you use not primarily to destroy military targets. You kind of use those military weapons in order to wage mass destruction on enemy countries or opposed countries. Russia in the media and Russian media, they have gone so far as to say, we can attack the Netherlands being a key strategical position in Europe. And they say, we attack the Netherlands. It's a very small target, just a few nukes or other military attacks. And there's one giant conflagration in Rotterdam. To the point is that the Netherlands is laid waste effectively. And nuclear weapons were clearly in that discussion on Russian TV an option. And they say then Europe will starve and be effectively destroyed. Now, let's step back for a second and contemplate what kind of an attitude that is. Russia here is acting with a degree of palpable despair. And then we have to ask ourselves, why the hell are they acting in this particular way? There's two kinds of behavior that can be at the root of this particular political strategies. The first one is despair. Like, we are so concerned about the situation, we are so concerned about our collective survival, that we fear immediate destruction or annihilation of the Russian state if we do not act. There's another explanation, and that's the explanation of a mob culture. Can be both. Now, what is a mob culture? A mob culture is where you have two sides in a country. You have the elite and you have the peasants. You have the exploiting class and a very, very large majority of people being exploited. Without any reservation, my opinion is, my sincerest belief is that in most countries in the world you have the similar situation, but in Russia this is pretty extreme. And how do you measure this? Russia is just oligarchs stealing stuff. Very demoralized and very draconic and bitter and expecting the worst kind of population. And those Russian oligarchs and elites who steal their money or steal stuff from the Russian collective, the country, the natural resources, the industrial resources, the production capacity, immediately export their money. That is the motive of a developing country, like what you see in Africa. You have leaders there, they getting power by playing all sides against one another, sort of like creating a sort of king, organizes a number of kingmakers around himself, the keys to the kingdom, so to speak. And with that particular power base, the elite of a particular country, which is a sort of a fascist neo-feudal model, take the resources and use them for their own personal profit, their own personal comforts. That's blow hookers, yachts, mansions, expensive trips for their kids, money, houses in Amsterdam and in Paris and the French Riviera. Yeah, multiple yachts, jewelry, blow hookers, whatever. This is very well documented. It's very clear that Russia is what you call a kleptocracy, where the system actually thrives on the elite stealing stuff. That makes me conclude largely that it's not an act of desperation. In part it is desperation, but it's more an act of cultivating and sustaining and perpetuating that kleptocratic system indefinitely. There is also a minor other component, and I insist we're talking about a minor other component, and that is that Putin is pretty old. There have been indications that he's sick, maybe terminally so, or he can clearly see his demise ahead of him. He might have thought 10 years ago that we would have life extension or something. He talked about that frequently, or AI or whatever, or singularity. But now he's starting to believe, oh my God, I'm going to die. And that is a very sobering thought for everyone. And amongst other things that go through your mind when you realize that death is near, it's a very increased, a sudden increased concern for your legacy. What do you leave behind? And it is no leap of the imagination looking at Putin that he looks around his country and sees nothing but devastation. Another factor is that Putin has increasingly become isolated because of the whole Corona situation. He definitely isolated himself. There have been assassination attempts on his life, so there's another reason for him to isolate. And as we know, aging, maybe slightly panicked dictators, when they are confronted with their own mortality, suddenly very, very harsh confrontation with their own mortality, they might not have access to the most ideal information, or they might be led with certain, by certain emotions. It's become very difficult for someone like Putin to make correct assessments. There's good indications that he is very isolated from correct information. It looks like he had very high expectations of his military. It looks like major elements of his military were corrupt. They were stealing. They were fattening their own wallets and their own pockets at the expense of the effectiveness of the Russian army. Putin may have been severely deluded about the capabilities of his own military on all levels. So the elite levels in terms of contracting, in terms of acquiring new equipment. So you get also second-rate equipment. Your orders are also corrupted. A lot of money is siphoned off through fake companies, etc. There's good analysis of that on YouTube. Then the second layer is the middle layer. Middle management is just stealing stuff. And at the lowest layer, soldiers are shirking their responsibilities, not exercising, trying to get out of things, or actually stealing if the opportunity arises. It's very clear that this has been happening at large scale in Russia. So the effectiveness of the Russian army may have been reduced from what Putin can be expected to assume about his own army, have been reduced by more than half. With an army like that, you can't make modern invasions, especially not against the Ukrainian army, which has been actively exercising with NATO for almost a decade. So on the one hand, Ukraine has been held against sort of more professional Western standards and has been evolving rapidly towards being a modern army. Not entirely, but Ukraine is still a mess, but comparatively, but they were definitely capable of striking very painful blows against the Russians. Now, one thing about the Russian army, which they still have, is artillery. And that's a very dark conclusion, because that means that Russia can still move artillery with a long range, and they can ignore human rights, war crimes, the concept of war crimes, human rights violations, Geneva Conventions, and they just bumble whole regions with artillery. They assume that everyone has fled. It's sort of a rounding error, and they inflict massive amount of damage on the civilian population. As people get used to that horrible realization that Russia has absolutely no concern about loss of human lives, their own soldiers or other side civilians, the tolerance of sort of like the outrage dulls a little, becomes sort of like a background clamor. And Russia says, okay, we can now strike. If Russia, if Ukraine serves us a painful blow, then we retaliate by striking civilian targets. They have been doing that. They strike civilian buildings, shopping centers, etc. in an increasing amount. We'll get back to the nukes in a minute. Russia now has a reasonable expectations to gradually winnow down Ukraine, but their own troops are definitely eroding. We can assume that somewhere in a couple of months, before the end of this year, that the Russian military has degraded to a point where they really cannot make any structural advances. They can move their artillery, but they can't defend their artillery against drone strikes or commando actions or something like that. So the war is going to bog down. Same will happen in Ukraine, but Ukraine is being served quite effective infantry weapons themselves. So yeah, this war is functionally over from both sides, and definitely from the Russian side, well before the end of this year. It can simmer on, no doubt. The war can then simmer on for 10 more years, but it would not be in the interest of Russia to go for that. Russia is now then faced with a really painful realization, is that if they grab the eastern half of Ukraine, the eastern and southern angle of Ukraine, without being able to secure Odessa, they don't have control of the Black Sea. That is basically their initiative, their military invasion, their invasion, their war has failed. Because they need to have complete control of the coastal area around the Black Sea in order to make this work. And most certainly, the bigger picture for Russia, to create a defensive bulwark on the western side of the former Soviet Union, is out of the table. They can no longer do anything about NATO. They now realize the slightest gesture towards NATO will pummel them completely in oblivion, and that immediately escalates the things to nuclear standoff, etc. So now comes the end discussion. We now have a sort of a good understanding, sort of a rudimentary understanding, an adequate understanding of why Russia does things, which is basically to perpetuate its own kleptocratic system and to make sure that the neighboring countries are not imposing upon the democracy. It is a great threat if Ukraine would join the EU or NATO and become a lot more democratic, introduce Western values. The consequences for Russia would be severe if that would happen, like very severe, and it would significantly erode the current status quo in Russia. People would start demanding, they would have a very clear example to the south, like if the Ukrainians can have affluence, prosperity, economic growth and democracy, why can't we? That would signify the end of the current status quo in Russia, and someone like Navalny could actually grasp the presidency in the next 10 or so years. That is unacceptable for Putin, then we return to his legacy. If he is exposed as being the asshole that completely robbed his country of trillions, that would make him the biggest piece of shit from Russian history. And I can imagine that that's not what he wants. He wants to be the ruthless, harsh, draconian leader that defended Russian national interests and identity against a degenerate and corrupt West, which is a very contrived and superficial propaganda motif. And then he can rest assured that when he dies, is replaced or whatever, that he retires, lives a few years, dies, and he has a large population that still admires him for a long time, for an indefinite future. Do realize there's a large contingent of Russians right now who still worship Stalin. Stalin, who was significantly worse by any measure than someone like Hitler, much more ruthless, and Hitler was already ridiculously ruthless. Hitler's regime, Hitler's government and apparatus and invasion was brutal, but Stalin was by many metrics more brutal, and still Russians to this day, large population, large segment of the older population still admires Stalin. They experienced an increase in comfort in their lives, which they cannot measure against the West. Especially old Russians have no clue. and they are just spiteful that all that was taken from them by, as they perceive it, a very corrupt, degenerate outside enemy. So I can assume that if Putin pulls this off, he can secure his legacy. And that's the third point of consideration for why he's doing this. So perpetuating the kleptocratic order, sort of strategically defending the Russian system against ideological and military threats. And most importantly, Putin wants his ego boost, realizing that he will be feared, respected after his death. I am not able to speculate whether Putin is really sick. It would be convenient if he were very sick and died in a year or so, but he could easily last several years more. And that brings us to the concept of nuclear weapons. Putin and his regime is insane enough and clearly desperate enough to, if they pummel Ukraine into submission, and they take large sections of Ukraine, maybe even up to Odessa, that would be the worst case scenario, that they would be so confident in saying, well, we now lost, say, 50 to 100,000 of our young soldiers. We cannot let their sacrifice go in vain, and therefore we have to proceed. Looking at the strategical interests in for Russia, this is already a major failure. Finland and Sweden joined NATO. So the Russians are fucked. They can no longer secure anything resembling what they cannot invade Finland. Finland will be a massacre towards the Russian army, probably many times over what they experienced in Ukraine. The Finnish, you do not fuck with the Finnish. And the Finnish would have full support of NATO. So that will be a slaughter of all, like 10 times as many young soldiers. Now come a very big problem. Russia, as a country, has stopped procreating in the 1980s for a whole range of reasons. I shall not go into these reasons, but they are easily reproducible. That basically means that Russia has a deficiency in young people. They haven't been educating properly their young people as well. So there, you can assume that, except for a very small elite, tech-savvy elite, that most Russians in the provinces are educated on a level of the developing world. But Russians are inbreeding. They don't have children. To the point is that Russian is demographically going off a cliff. And imagine a country with nothing but old people, a giant continent with nothing but old people, then Russia must exert a certain amount of dread on its subsidiary republics, like something like Siberia. That's a lot of non-Russians, ethnic non-Russians there. Large sections of the Ural are rife with resistance movements and people who really would like to secede from Russia. Russia has only 20 years, 10 years from now, it doesn't have an army to occupy its own country, to submit, to dominate its own country and its own wayward republics from breaking away. The point where republics will start breaking away is within one generation. There's nothing that Russia can do about it except use nuclear weapons. But even then, the first time they use a nuclear weapon is that several republics will immediately break away. Use nuclear weapon here, then over here, a whole bunch of people will say, I want out of this arrangement immediately. Holding a gun to one person's head immediately makes clear what your intentions and your values are. That basically means that a whole bunch of people behind you will run towards the exit. Russia realizes this. And I would assume that they're completely desperate about this in a collective system. They have no solutions towards education. They have no solutions against like major problems like TB, tuberculosis, AIDS, massive rampant meth and drug use in Russia, Alcoholism, don't get me started on the amount of damage that alcoholism is wreaking upon that country. Large sections of the Russian population are now trying to emigrate and go for other countries and live abroad, especially it's highly educated young. They are leaving for the door. So we can, I'm absolutely certain that Russia has no future as a system. His idea that he had quickly to invade Ukraine and quickly follow up in Transnistria, that would be perfect. but he can't. That's no longer possible. And that must be extremely painful for the system. And if there's one thing to be said about the collective mindset of Russia compared to other countries, it's stubbornness. It's a foolhardy, dogged, irrational, draconian stubbornness. It is a mentality of a country that says, okay, we have 10 soldiers, we have one rifle, we have 20 bullets, we send one soldier forward, he dies, other soldiers take the gun, and they advance, they die, other soldiers take that single gun. They throw human meat, human lives at a problem, because that's all they have. And that's the attitude of a gangster. Like, let me repeat, that's the attitude of a gangster elite, a kleptocratic, ruthless gangster elite. We've seen that in the last century very clearly. Not just in Russia, mind you, we see it in America as well. But if Russia has been an exemplary of this paradigm. So it is flipping a coin to see what comes up. This is a random phenomenon. This is a random process. It is not certain. There's no deterministic outcome in this. And it could be, and that's the reason why I make this video, is that Russia is going to use nuclear weapons. They have a trump card. They have their dogged, stubborn, almost psychiatric levels of stubborn persistence, and they have nukes. And could it be that the inner circle of around Putin is so ideologically rotten and so furiously obstinate that they could say, to hell with it. We know that Russia is historically on the way out. 20 years, there will not, literally not be a Russia. There will be like a Moscow with some Russia draped around it. But for instance, Kaliningrad will be German or Polish 20 years from now. That's a certainty. Maybe St. Petersburg will turn into a republic. There is a large section in Russia which was formerly Karolinia, something like that, formerly Swedish or Finnish, and most likely they will join Finland again because they still have an enormous amount of ethnic Finnish-speaking Finns over there, living over there. They will leave, and Russia is aware of this. To the south, there's whole sections of Russia that immediately want to secede, given the first opportunity. The only reason why they in the east might not is fear of China, but then again, China has quite comparable problems in terms of population decrease, quite comparable problems in a completely unsustainable system, large sections of their leadership being very corrupt and extremely kleptocratic. So to assume that China would, say, invade Kazakhstan or Siberia, I really do not see that happen, because I think that China is headed for a comparable future. But that's the topic for another video. Could it be that through a confluence of hasty and irrational emotions and follow-up chain of event of decisions, Russia would say, and they nuke, let's say, Berlin or Amsterdam or Paris or London or several of these? Yes. Yes. And that's a very, very painful realization. Right now, taking everything into account, we must conclude that there is a pathology in the Russian leadership right now, a combination of disattachment, a combination of blazing guns, running to the enemy with thinking, if I scream really hard, maybe the enemy will retreat. It's clear that the enemy is not retreating, and actually the enemy is getting ready for Russia invasion. So they can't militarily, in conventional military attacks, do anything. So what could they do? Well, that opens up an interesting set of possibilities. What Russia could do, and this is realistic from their perspective, and that's the first scenario. That's like a sudden escalation, a sudden burst of irrationality, like a drunk with a knife running at the police. Overconfidence. And that's EMP attacks. It could be that Russia says, if we detonate a carpet of electromagnetic pulse attacks on our strategic enemies, and I'm thinking several countries in the Middle East, and I'm thinking Western Europe, large sections of Western Europe, and then dodging the parts of Western Europe which have their doubts, like say Hungary, you don't attack, but Germany, you attack, France, you attack, UK, you attack, like I said, Sweden now, and Finland, most likely, and then you inundate those countries, what we call electromagnetic pulse, you more or less destroy the infrastructure for a decade. The electrical infrastructure, the IT infrastructure is gone. That more or less means you blanket Western Europe in a famine that lasts for a decade. The system in Western Europe will be disrupted to a point where for many years there will be severe incapacitating famine and mass death. You cannot take the electronic infrastructure out of a modern country without having severe painful repercussions. People will die in hospitals, food won't get delivered, farming equipment won't work, infrastructure logistics will be completely disrupted, factories won't work, the electricity grid will be disabled for at least several years. If you do that to the United States at the same time as well, then you could, in theory, strike a blow. Or Russia may be led to conclude that they can strike a blow. That they think, we can define this as winning. That is, of course, a psychiatric level of delusion, but Russia will not automatically realize that. You don't, as an insane person, don't realize that you're insane. This is a scenario where they think we might be able to do this. And it's not a scenario where they say, okay, we send in the army immediately because they know they will be hit as well. But they might say, well, we have something like a nuclear winter or mass disruption. Well, that is not much worse than what we're used to already or what we have to look forward to in the next 10 or 20 years, considering all the sanctions against us. So they might say, we are getting our asses beat anyway as a collective nation. Why not do it to our strategical enemies and adversaries before we have to endure that fate ourselves and with our lonely selves in a country that's collapsing around us? If you look at what the media, the Russian media right now is saying, that is the mindset of what you hear in Russia. Listen to that interesting TV program with that genetic psychopath with the ridiculously thick glasses. And the screaming host of on Russian Kremlin-operated propaganda TV. That's what they're saying. That is the mindset of these people. These people are in a state close to frenzy. That's the first trigger for nuclear war. The second trigger for nuclear war is that right now, certain elements in, and I'm thinking specifically America, are thinking we have to slowly but surely erode Russia. And we have to, because Russia won't stop. Russia is in a sort of a manic state, a manic, insane, directionless state, and they are going to push up against their boundaries, and if not now, they are definitely going to make a move several years from now after they consolidated Ukraine. We saw it happen in 2015, 2014. My dog is becoming insane here. Hey. We saw this happen in 2014, and then nothing happened, and now are we going to back down, and again this is going to return in our lap 4, 5, 6 years from now? It may be that America is behind the scenes becoming increasingly vicious, and all they have every right. Still, nuclear weapons are aimed at America, so you can't assume that NATO is fighting this fairly, or whatever is fairly. But from a Russian perspective, you can't assume that America is fighting fairly. So America might be escalating in several covert ways. For instance, quite a few top brass of the Russian army has been mysteriously dying. Let's say there is a gathering of high officers in the Russian army somewhere in Ukraine, and then mysteriously Vaktiar drone strikes on that spot. That strongly suggests that the NATO is feeding intelligence, like major components of military intelligence, to the Ukrainian army. They are using Ukraine to massacre the Russian infrastructure and military, and they're being very successful. Ukraine has basically no alternative, because if they don't have this support from the West, their country is gone, and their population is scattered over Western Europe as low-wage labor. That's a fate too terrible, too horrible to contemplate for the typical Ukrainian. So Ukraine, having a sort of Slavic mentality and also a fair share of stubbornness, will throw everything, and at some point 16-year-old boys with Kalashnikovs, at the Russian army to stop them. Because what other alternative, ideologically sound alternative, does Ukraine have? And considering the success of Ukraine, a little less the last month, but for the last months, Ukraine has had captured the world imagination. Considering the success America might go a little too far in this. America and NATO have their reasons, and at some point they trigger in this hornet's nest of military balances and constantly shifting mechanisms. They trigger some sort of failsafe or automatic response, and something or someone launches nukes. That's the second thing, is then the chaos, ensuing chaos and dirty warfare and covert means that both sides not even fully understand the implications of that. This ongoing conflict triggers some kind of mechanism. So that's not an irrational thing, but it is chaos, sort of chaos itself triggering a nuclear response. And the third risk is the chances on an outside force intervening is small, but it's there. If now a nuclear warhead or nuclear device explodes near or in Russia, let's say in Moscow, then an outside agency can more or less take over. Say China smuggles a nuke to Russia, detonates it somewhere near Moscow. Russia will launch everything they have. That's a small risk. That's a very small risk. That's so viciously evil. But there are players in the Middle East, and there are players in Asia and North Korea that might be sort of seduced into solving their own mounting problems in this way. A remote possibility. What's way more likely is Ukraine. People in Ukraine, certain elements in Ukraine, they have access to several operational nuclear reactors. What if they have a small stockpile of uranium or weaponizable plutonium? What if they covertly hidden a few nukes? What if they buy a nuke or someone donates a nuke? Say North Korea donates a nuke, very remote possibility, but some outside player donates a nuke to Ukraine, and Ukraine finds itself a half a year or a year from now devastated, massacred, say 20% of the population dead or mutilated or like incapable of working, shell-shocked, hateful. Maybe the West is slowly and gradually abandoning Ukraine, and Ukraine, certain elements or the government or Ukraine say, fuck this, and they detonate a small but effective nuclear weapon, maybe enriched with some cobalt, in or near Moscow. Dirty weapons are generally a sort of like an exaggerated threat. They're not that dramatic. It's something like a small chemical factory exploding, and something like Bhopal, the disaster in India. That's what the effect of a dirty nuclear bomb does. But a fairly robust nuclear device, let's say, Hiroshima style, and a whole bunch of cobalt, that's really dirty, in a truck. So you have an old truck and it drives around in Russia. Nobody notices it. Nobody pays attention to it because that country is a mess. It drives from the east to a big city, St. Petersburg or Moscow. And the whole thing is filled with, to the brim, with chemicals and cobalt, old junk cobalt, doesn't have to cost too much. And let's say two of those trucks, and they both detonate exactly at the same moment or just shortly after one another. It would cause some significant pollution in terms of radioactivity, but the panic itself would immediately destroy Russia as a country. Russia would immediately collapse. So the pain and anguish, that's three, the pain and anguish of a collapsing Ukraine, or maybe the fear of another Russian Republic being next in line for this, they could say, to hell with it. And there is potential for malignant external or internal actors, maybe even in Russia itself. Who is to know in this clusterfuck? The potential here that again Russia does click and start launching is considerable. They might start launching towards Ukraine if they get what's happening, or they might say it's NATO is behind it, the Jews and the homosexuals of Europe are behind this, the communists, the socialists and the fascists and the Nazis are behind this, whatever kind of the psychotic delusion they're currently caught in there, and they start launching. It may be that if they lose Moscow in this particular manner, is that they realize that their country is going to completely, their enormous geographic region is completely going to unravel. The horror scenarios in their head are analog to what you saw in World War II at the end, when Hitler said, if there is no national socialism, the world can go to hell, Germany can go to hell, because that's the end of anything that's meaningful. That vicious ideological mindset is what you right now clearly see in the Russian media. What to do about this? I'm going to say something horrible. Of course, NATO realizes all this, and NATO is ready for this. And I think that NATO is ready with an answer that is very quick, very effective, and very intimidating, and that the only chance that NATO has to immediately stop this is destroy a Russian city. So if something bad happens, Russia is mobilizing towards nuclear war, which is fairly visible for intelligence systems. NATO has just boom, strike immediately. And then start talking with Russia, what's left of Russia. And that's probably going to be Moscow. So a fairly solid nuclear weapon at Moscow, and then what's left of Russia, the military leadership, and say, well, shall we continue this? because it's your families that are going to die. It's your sons and daughters that are going to be nuclear incinerated, and you won't even find their corpses in St. Petersburg or any of another 10 or 20 big Russian cities. I think that NATO, if NATO is prompted to do this, they will go for Moscow. Why? Because that's complete decapitation of the system. It's a very centralized bureaucratic system. It can't function without a central government, and a large several megaton strike at the core of Moscow will immediately decapitate. Maybe a few adjacent strikes to places where it can be assumed that Putin is at that time, or his generals are, or the chief of his military are at the time. There will be counter-strikes, but to be realistic, it may be that I am dead a year from now because of this. Realistic, I'd say 5%, because Western Europe has been hit in a counter-strike, and there's nothing left of me. I'm part of the upper atmosphere, and that we have to live in a world where nuclear weapons have been used. And then we'll say, the collective, what's left of humanity, will collectively say, this will never happen again for 50 or 100 years, and then it will happen again, maybe. I don't know, people forget. But we now have to contend with the fact and the reality that Russia is going to lash out with nuclear weapons for whatever complex, contrived system of reasons. Or that NATO says they are very close to doing this, let's be first, as to surgically decapitate the Russian system and engage in a conversation with what is left. I can only assume, if I made the right conclusions, that this is what's happening right now, and this is what is ahead of us. And the horrible realization is this may be the best scenario we have. A limited nuclear war where several cities are incinerated in the face of a completely irrational, psychotic, fact-denying, aggressive, angry, insulted, dishonored, kind of pathetic Russia, because what's happening the last few months has been a bit on the pathetic side. In the face of that, we may conclude that this is not unrealistic. The worst case scenario is a full engagement. Escalation, a conflict in, say, Kaliningrad, a conflict along the Polish border, Polish forces engage in Belarus, boom, full launch. Both sides. Russia starts launching, America starts launching, and the world loses a billion people in the ensuing hour or week, because a lot of people die when the first hits, but most people die in the aftermath. Radiation, starvation, local conflicts, disorder, disruption of services. If you completely disagree with this, please feel free to email me. If you say, oh, this is pretty realistic stuff, feel free to email me and engage. I will place this on Twitter. Most likely only a dozen people will see it. But who knows? Many people will see it. Maybe a lot of people will see it. And they will merit it with a response. But it's something which we must face, that, yeah, nuclear war is now a possibility, considering how things have degenerated.